cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree.
His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God. Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King.
Oh, praise the name.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh Lord our God. He shall return in robes of white, the blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Praise the name.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God.
Sing, oh, praise the name.
Oh,
two. enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He's made me glad, oh, he's made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He's made me glad, oh, he's made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He's made me glad, oh, he's made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He's made me glad, oh, he's made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Hallelujah, he has made me glad. Hallelujah, he has made me glad. Hallelujah, oh, he has made me glad. Hallelujah, 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 he has made me glad. Made me glad. Made me glad. He has made me glad. Oh, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. Oh, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. Oh, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. Oh, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way, and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. He says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress."
Good morning, church. I'm Don, and I would like to welcome you to Wesley Church Online. Today, we are starting a new series titled Greater Than. This new series will be coinciding with a stewardship campaign meant to dream God-sized dreams together and collect pledges from our church family to give legs to those dreams. During worship today, I invite you to connect with our church family via the chat box to the right of your screen. There are three things to do there. Number one, right now, there is someone God is putting in your heart. Maybe it's a son or a daughter, or a coworker or a friend. Whoever it may be, invite them to church today. The good news of Jesus is open to all, and Jesus commands the church to be sharers of that news. So go ahead and click the invite button and bring someone to church with you today. Or send them this link now, wesley.online.church. That's wesley.online.church. And if you are watching this on YouTube, be sure to hit that like and subscribe button, and then share this video with that special person in your heart. Number two, if you're new with us, be sure to fill out the I'm New Here card, and Pastor James will reach out to you sometime this week and guide you in how to grow deeper in your faith. Finally, throughout this service, be sure to share your joys and your concerns there, and we'd love to pray for you today. Remember, God loves you, and so do we. So come and join us in the call to worship. Friends, we serve a God who designed us for community. Come, let us worship together. We serve a God who doesn't ask us to go alone. Come, let us sing together. We're loved by a God who chooses to be with us. Come, let us walk together. Please join me in the unison prayer. God, we gather as a people who want community more than company, and who would rather be known by each other than to look like we have our lives together. Lead us as we grow closer together by worshiping you. Teach us that life together is better than isolation. It is in your name that we pray. Amen.
It's keep making movements to you.
This week begins a special worship series and stewardship campaign entitled Greater Than. Now, typically, we would have a stewardship campaign in the fall, but if you remember last November, we were all in the midst of much financial uncertainty and fear. I believe that as we are returning to the building and at last able to regather again in person, God is calling our church into a season of celebrating God's protection in the past and aligning our dreams with God's dreams for the future through a stewardship campaign in July. During the 4 weeks of July, we will reflect on the greater than generosity of God upon our lives this past year, and how God is calling us also to be as irrationally generous. Generosity is about aligning our priorities with God's priorities, aligning our hearts with God's heart. When God's church is generous in treasures, time, and talents, God is able to do far much greater than we ask or imagine, according to the power that is at work within us. So mark your calendars for July 25th, when we will gather for worship and a commitment celebration. Your presence is important as our congregation considers the next steps for our mission and ministry, Greater Than Dreams. We hope to see you there. Part of why we give is because we don't do life alone. In some seasons, we will have plenty, and in others, we will have little. Let us give generously so that we may carry one another, for we do not do life alone. If you are prepared to give, there are three ways that you can give today. You can mail a check to our church at 1500 Plainfield Avenue, South Plainfield, New Jersey, 07080. You can give online at wumcsp.org/give, or you can give through the Tithely app. On behalf of Wesley Church, I want to thank you for your generosity. Because of your continued faithful giving, we can continue to be sharers of God's love to our hurting community and world. Please join me in the offering prayer. Great Provider, we offer you these gifts, trusting that your work is best accomplished when we join together. In letting go, may we discover something greater than what we could have known on our own. Inspire us with your dreams for our ministry. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Today's scripture reading is from Acts chapter 2, verses 14 to 28. Peter addresses the crowd. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was written through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heavens above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You that are Israelites, listen to what I have to say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonders, and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know. This man handed over to you, according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. But God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand so that I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart was glad and my tongue rejoiced. Moreover, my flesh will live in hope. For you will not abandon me to my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One experience corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. the Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning, church. Pastor James here. As you can see, I am not at church. I am also not at home. Right now, I am in the middle of my family trip. I'm taking a week off with my family. Right now, I'm at my aunt's house in Albany to just rest, to restore, to recover. And I'm going to pull back the curtain just a little bit further. Typically, I would have a lot more time to prepare for a sermon during the week. And also, for our online worship, I typically have a teleprompter with my sermon manuscript so that I make sure I'm always looking at you and focusing on you. So time and teleprompter, I have neither of them. So I had a lot less time to prepare for the sermon. I don't have a teleprompter today. I just have a small camera I brought, and my manuscript is here in front of me. But I'm still carving out a little bit of my time to share a message with you that has been a blessing to me, because I am so excited for this new sermon series that we are starting. I know some of you are holding off your July 4th celebrations. You're carving out that 1 hour just to tune into worship today. Well, I thought it would be appropriate for me also to just carve out just an hour to speak to you today. I'm so thankful you are here. So today, again, I'm so excited. We are starting a new series titled Greater Than. During the 4 weeks of July, we're going to be reflecting on the greater than dreams that God places on God's people. Specifically, we're going to be talking about generosity, right? When God's church is generous in time and treasures and talents, God is able to do far greater than we can possibly imagine according to the power that is at work within us. So today I'll be preaching on the title and starting off the series. The title for today's sermon is We is Greater Than Me. We is Greater Than Me. Let us pray before we begin. Will you join me? Almighty God, I thank you for this July 4th Sunday, this time that we can reflect on the freedom, not only in this country, but really the freedom that you give to us through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that unites us. Lord, you have a greater than dream for Wesley Church. I know it. And I pray that you would speak through this very insufficient servant, Lord. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing in your sight, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. There is a Burkinabe proverb that goes like this. If you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. Growing up, I had two brothers. I had a younger brother and an older brother. And, you know, having the three of us together had its fair share of complexities, but they were immensely outweighed by the benefits of having two brothers, right? As a child, I always had someone to play with. And playing with toys was always more interesting because there were multiple storylines happening among the toys at the same time. Meals were a journey of hearing about how each other's weeks were, and then also hearing about the future dreams that we all had. And moving. When we're moving from one house to another, once my brothers and I reached high school, we didn't have to hire moving companies because among the three of us, we could carry most furniture and we could carry most heavy boxes. We took care of the moving. We were always better together. Now, once I went to college, I more or less benefited, I reaped the benefits of being alone. You know, when I wanted to go somewhere, I didn't have to wait for someone to put on their socks or to get ready, right? I could just get in the car and go. When I wanted to eat something, I didn't have to be concerned about what other people wanted to eat. I just bought and ate, right? I was in control of my life. I was in control of my destiny. I was able to go fast because I was alone. But work was less interesting when I was alone. Meals tasted a bit more bland. When it came time to move, I remember having a really terrible experience. Because before, mind you, if there were 10 boxes, by the time I made one trip, moving one box, there were already two or three other boxes that have already been moved. I only had to do like three trips to take care of 10 boxes. Meanwhile, when I'm moving by myself, it's 10 trips, right? You know what I'm talking about? Why do we prefer seeing movies while accompanied by a friend? Why do we pack ourselves into stadiums and concert halls to sit shoulder to shoulder with strangers? Why does a sunset seem so sublime when the moment is shared with someone without even saying a word? A fascinating study led by Yale psychologist Eric Boothby, John Barg, and Margaret Clark demonstrated that life is quite literally sweeter when we share in our experiences. So in this study, research participants rated a pleasant tasting chocolate as more likable and more flavorful when another individual they didn't know was eating the same chocolate at the same time, even though they didn't communicate with each other. And then they did another experiment, and the researchers found that when participants tasted an unpleasant tasting chocolate, they were more likely to dislike the experience when another person next to them was also eating that same bitter chocolate, right? So the researchers concluded this way, quote, "Sharing an experience with another person without communicating amplifies one's experience. Both pleasant and unpleasant experiences were more intense when shared." Our life experiences are amplified, they are heightened, they become more tangible, if you will, when we experience them together. We can all think of times when something was easier or more successful when we worked together rather than alone. But it's not just about combining resources. There is something special that happens when we work together. You know, I like to take a little creative liberty with that Burkinabe proverb that I started with and say that if you want to go fast, dream alone. But if you want to go far, we need to dream together. Because when we dream together, God-sized dreams, the church can change the world. Specifically in today's reading in Acts chapter 2 on the Pentecost event, there are three characteristics of the early church that we can see here that will challenge us today. Number one, a God-sized dream requires more than one person. Number two, a God-sized dream results in polarizing responses. And number three, a God-sized dream transforms the world. So let's unpack these further. Number one, a God-sized dream requires more than one person. So before Jesus ascends into heaven after his resurrection, he tells his disciples to wait in Jerusalem. And there in the upper room, the room begins to shake. There's an earthquake, a mighty wind rushes in, and tongues of fire come over all the disciples, and they begin to express powerful spiritual gifts, including speaking in multiple different languages. A powerful movement is beginning, and Peter, the Apostle Peter, comes out and addresses the crowd. And so our reading begins this way in verse 14. "Then Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say.'" Note here that although Peter is the primary speaker, he isn't standing by himself, right? He isn't a lone wolf who figured it out all on his own, but rather he is being supported by, he's being empowered by, he's standing with, it says, standing with the 11. That's what scripture says in verse 14. He's standing with the 11. You know, there was a meme I saw on social media that was shared on our church's Facebook page, and it goes like this, quote, "It takes 6 or 8 pallbearers to lift you up when you are deceased. Imagine what you can accomplish if you had 6 or 8 people lifting you up while you are living." And later we learned that people were moved and wanted to be baptized. And if Peter were alone, he wouldn't have been able to baptize all those people. But because he was not alone, because he was with his community, working together, he was standing with the 11 and many more disciples, later we learned that 3,000 folks were baptized that day. 3,000 folks were baptized that day. He could not have done that if he were all by himself. When the Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost, men and women of all ages, all social classes had visions and dreams. Together, they had a vision greater than what they could have had alone. Even though they spoke different languages and came from different walks of life, the Spirit enabled them to understand each other and be united in their vision for community. A God-sized dream requires more than one person. It requires us to dream together. But then we come to number two. Number two, a God-sized dream results in polarizing responses. And I think this is really important. A God-sized dream results in polarizing responses. So verses 12 and 13, before our reading, just to set the premise, this is what verse 12 say. It says this, "All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They are filled with new wine.'" I remember being taught that as a leader, if no one is complaining to me, if everyone seems to be content, that means your organization is stuck, dying, or already dead. Because to be alive means to be changing and growing and developing. And this requires bold change that oftentimes shakes up the status quo, right? I know I have three children and I love them to death. And, you know, we often joke when we see cute babies, right? You know, please stop growing up, right? You're growing up too fast. When did you get so big? Stop growing up, right? We joke about it all the time. But if my children really did not grow up, right? If 10 years into their life, they're still 20 inches tall and I need to change their diapers every 2 hours, you would say, what? There's a medical problem. Something's wrong, right? If something living isn't growing and changing, then you would say something is wrong. And God-sized movements are especially so. When the Holy Spirit came on and the disciples began speaking in multiple languages, onlookers were amazed, right? It says onlookers were amazed, but then it says that some sneered and thought that they were drunk. I think this is really important to see. If we are following God's vision for our lives, for our church, some will think that we are drunk. Some will think that we are drunk. You know, the disciples could have said, hey, you know, if we start talking in different languages, you know, it might make other people feel a little uncomfortable. It might make people feel weird. Let's just, you know what? Let's not rock the boat. Let's keep our mouths shut so that people are comfortable, right? If they did this, none of the other people would have complained. No one would have accused them of morning intoxication. But also, then Pentecost Day would have just been another Thursday. Everyone would have just gone about their day, business as usual. But when the disciples acted upon the Holy Spirit's movement, when the early church took hold boldly of the God-sized dream, right? It won't make sense to everyone, but in the end, it shook the world, right? 3,000 people were baptized and the church was born. And right away, some of the people watching are moved and challenged by what they see, while others sneer and accuse these Jesus followers of being drunk. Wesley Church, if we are a church dreaming God-sized dreams, being led by the power of the Holy Spirit, then some are always going to be sneering. We can't be worried about making everybody happy and comfortable, but rather we need to be focused on the God-sized dream and be unified in our vision that God has for us because, number three, a God-sized dream transforms the world. God makes the same promise to us as to those gathered at Pentecost, that when we follow Jesus, we will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit inspires our dreams and aligns our vision with God's vision, aligns our dreams with the God-sized dreams for us and for our community. You know, on Homecoming Sunday, we ask you to fill out a leaf, right, to write your greater than dream that God was putting on your heart. And we are planning to post these leaves on a bulletin board in the church so that we can all see and read them together. But if you haven't filled it out yet, there's still time. There's still leaves to fill out. But the stewardship team, we gathered together and we began reading some of the leaves that were already filled out on Homecoming Sunday. And I just want to share with you the top three categories, the top three dreams shared by our church family. Number one, the most often noted dream, was in regards to evangelism and a large growth in our church family to reach people that are not being reached right now with the gospel of Jesus Christ. They dream of a growing church, a living church, amen, a growing church, right? Someone wrote that they dream that the sanctuary will be filled up, including the balconies at both services, that we have to start a third service. Amen, amen. That was the most frequently named dream in among the leaves. And number two was the growth of our children's ministry and our youth ministry. To see more children in our filling up the church, and to see more and more youth and young adults taking ownership of the church, taking serving in leadership positions in the church. Someone wrote on their leaf that they would love to see the Cultivate pastoral internship that we led, which led to the leadership of folks like Braden DeBrinio and Elizabeth Chin. They would love to see this program continue and maybe even have more than one intern at a time. Another person wrote that they would love to see our annual budget, our church's annual budget, to actually pay for high quality kids ministry curriculum and to cover for the Ignite conference for our youth and to pay for annual life-changing summer camps for our youth students, right? Amen, amen. And number three was the most frequently named dream. Number three was the development of worship and music ministries. There was a lot of excitement on Homecoming Sunday with the growing excitement and energy and momentum of the music ministries, and they were naming how they would love to see it grow even more, right? Growing our choirs, growing our band, creating life-changing worship experiences, right? Choirs that don't sing to perform, but really usher in an atmosphere of God-honoring worship. And, you know, many named how it was already starting to come to fruition in our services recently, right? Music that brings healing and restoration and reflects the kingdom of God. When we love to see the kingdom of heaven come to earth during our music ministries. You know, I shared with you in the newsletter my personal dream in regards to this, that I dream that through powerful worship ministries, I dream of a church where lives are being changed in the pews on Sundays long before I get up to preach. Wesley Church, I want to share one more dream. I dream of a church that is active in missions, both locally and globally. So locally, I dream of the end of hunger in our local community through the sandwich ministries and through ministries of the Hillside Community Food Bank. Globally, the last time, you know, we had a mission team visit Naigita Village in Kenya was 2012. That's 9 years ago. I dream of another mission team being sent next year, maybe even, right? Next year, in celebration of our 10-year anniversary, to rekindle and strengthen our relationship with the Naigita Village and with the Naigita Education Center that we have such a strong relationship with. You know, church family, these aren't just large dreams that I'm naming. These are God-sized dreams. These are impossible dreams in many ways. I'm sure as I'm sharing some of these dreams, some of you are thinking, well, Pastor James, that's impossible because of this and that and that. We can't do that in this way. That's not possible. Some of you might even think that I'm drunk. That's how crazy it is, right? Remember, unless people think that we are drunk, the dream is not big enough. Because we are the church, and God is calling us into His dreams, God's visions, so that He might transform the world through us. If we want to go fast, we can dream alone. But if you want to really go far, join us in dreaming God-sized dreams together. So, you might be asking, Pastor James, how do I join in this collective God-sized dreaming? Well, there are two things that you should really write down. There are two things that two ways in which you can join in this movement. Number one, I say this often and I'll say it again, and I think this is really the, if you haven't done this already, this is the time to do it. Number one, join a small group. Join a small group. This month, for the month of July, for 4 weeks, that's all I'm asking, for 4 weeks, we will be going through a special curriculum that is going to help us have dialogue about the God-sized dreams for Wesley. The divine spark in you is needed to complete the vision God has for us. If you aren't already part of a small group, join a small group today. You can sign up at our website, wumcsp.org/small groups, and click join a group, and we can join one right then and there. Number two to write down, in the mail, you will be receiving a green pledge card that looks something like this. I'll put it over here. Corbin, if you could just put it right there. And if you don't receive it by the end of the week, please email us at office@wumcsp.org to make sure that you also receive a green pledge card. But when you receive this card, I invite you to take the next few weeks to pray about how you might commit to dreaming together through your time, treasures, and talents. Specifically, the card is going to ask you, number one, how much time you will give towards prayer, how long you will pray each week for the movement of the Holy Spirit at Wesley Church. Prayer changes the world. So I invite you to write down, just make a commitment, how many minutes you're going to pray each week for the church. Number two is how much financially you will commit to giving to Wesley Church in 2021 and 2022. And a little bit about the financial pledging, I feel like needs to be clarified. If you feel weird about pledging financially, I get it. I personally am a tither, but I'm not really a pledger. I've never really written a pledge card before until I came to Wesley Church. You know, for me, I'm a tither, right? Whatever comes into my bank account, I give at least 10% to the church before I make any other purchases. And, you know, to anticipate a year ahead saying that I'm going to give X amount feels a bit weird, right? It's like, what if I don't hit that number? Am I going to be shamed, right? There's that mentality. And again, I get it. And this pledging, it's not about shaming people. That's not what pledging is about. But it is about making the commitment to say that this is God's church and I am a member of this church. I belong to this church. Even if you put down $100, right? You are saying, I am a member of this church. I belong to this church. And also, and this is more of a practical reason, just like how when we are all start writing on our leaves and begin to all share our dreams together, we are able to better discern the heart of our church body, where we are headed as a church. So if, for instance, if 100% of our congregation were to pledge, even if it's not 100% accurate, if 100% folks say, this is what I think I'll be able to give to the church in the next year, our church leadership would be able to better dream the God-sized dreams and discern where God is leading our church, right? Pledging puts legs on our God-sized dreams. I'll say that again. Pledging puts legs on our God-sized dreams. So I invite you, and I'm going to be challenged too, but I'm going to challenge myself as well. I'm going to challenge all of you to pledge financially, even if it's just a little bit, whatever you feel like God is putting on your heart to give, to put that down and to pledge. And number three on this card, the card will ask you how you will offer the empowered spiritual gifts, your talents, to then empower the church. Maybe God has been nudging you to serve in our growing kids ministry. Maybe God has been nudging you to serve as an usher as we return to in-person worship. I know for a lot of you, maybe most of you, if not all of you, God is nudging you to serve either in our sandwich ministry or the Hillside Food Bank mission work. Whatever it is, take this month to prayerfully discern and complete this card and submit it during our Commitment Sunday on July 25th. Church, I dream another crazy dream that 100% of you will complete your pledge cards. That is my dream, that 100% of you will complete your pledge cards, because pledging puts legs on our dreams. Imagine what a church can do when we are all pledged. We can appropriately dream and put to action the God-sized dreams when our church body are all in. Our music ministry will be transformed into a life-changing ministry when we are all in. Our children's ministry and youth ministry will be exploding in numbers and in depth of faith when we are all in. Our church family will be growing, and more people will encounter the grace and love, the salvific power of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ when we are all in. Peter quotes the prophet Joel when he says, "In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy." If you want to go fast, dream alone. But if you want to go far, where God is leading you, then join us in dreaming the God-sized dreams together. Beloved, commit, pledge, and join in, and let us witness a transformed world together, because we is greater than me. Amen. Beloved, if you are ready to say yes to the God-sized dreams for our church, then I invite you now to please join me in the table of Holy Communion. Now, this is not my table. This is not a Wesley Church's table. This is not the United Methodist Church's table. This is Christ's table. This is Jesus' table. And when it comes to the redeeming love of Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit, young and old, man or woman, black or white, all are welcome. So if you're ready, go ahead and bring your own elements, bread or cracker, and some grape juice if you have, some wine if you have, and let us be united through this holy meal. Will you join me? The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life, the power of your Holy Spirit that changes us and renews us and gives us new life. You know, when we turned away and when our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through the prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church on Pentecost Sunday, delivered us from the slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus gathered with his disciples, and he took bread, and he gave thanks to you. And he broke the bread, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. I invite you now to just put your hands over the elements as we bless them together and invite them, the Holy Spirit, in this very moment. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry in all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Please join me in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you now to partake in this meal. If you are with somebody, I invite you to break off a piece of the bread or the cracker and to say these words: this is the body of Christ broken for you. And then to take the cup, to dip it in, and to say these words: this is the blood of Christ shed for you. Almighty God, you spoke to the prophet Joel, and you reiterated through the apostle Peter that on the last days you'll pour out your spirit on all flesh, young and old, men and women, even slave and free. You say that all will prophesy, see visions, dream dreams. And Lord, we know that you are calling us towards life-changing, God-sized dreams that we cannot possibly imagine on our own. God, where are you leading our church? You know. Inspire us, empower us, instill in us your excitement and hope that we may go forth as your church, sharing your love with our neighbors and with the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to my home on God's celestial shores. I'll fly away. I'll fly away. When the sorrows of this life are gone, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars has flown, I'll fly away. I'll fly away. Joys will never end. Oh yes, I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away. Oh glory, I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, by and by I'll fly away. I said, now don't you know that when I die, by and by, I'll fly away. I'll fly away. Hey, I said I'm gonna go and fly away.
Hey. And now receive the blessing. Go forth, children of the Most High God, recipients of the greatest love this world has ever known. Dreaming the greater than God-sized dreams together, because we is greater than me. Go forth, sharing in that amazing news of this life-changing, radical community of love with our neighbors and with the world. In the name of the one who is our creator, our redeemer, and our sustainer. Amen. I'm so glad that you joined us for worship today. Just carved out that 1 hour for during this July 4th Sunday. I'm so thankful that you are here, and I hope that this service has been life-changing for you and life-giving for you. And I encourage you to go forth for the rest of this holiday, for the rest of this week, sharing in that amazing love, being an ambassador of that amazing news and that amazing love, and begin to invite yourself into aligning with God's dreams for you and for our church. So let us dream together, church. Have a blessed day, a blessed week, and I hope to see you next week. And until then, know that God loves you, and so do we. Take care.